Let's talk about, Mr. Fashua mentioned something about borrowing with the intention of not paying. How does that work?
Well, I think when I heard that, I mean, I was a bit taken aback. I think that's a nation state, in Nigeria,
that
for instance.
That shouldn't be, or yes, that can't be the
yes, we mustn't go
the
at,
intention.
You know, yes, I mean, even at the level of at individual level, you know, and you want to go and take money for somebody, it's a height of irresponsibility for you to borrow this money, knowing within yourself that this money, I don't intend to pay this money. I think it's a terrible thing to happen. You know, so you borrow money and then down the road you had expectations, and those expectations didn't carry. And so you have issues, you have problems. Fine, you know, that could happen to everybody. So you did some projections, and those projections did not materialize.
Yeah.
But when you, like you did say, that way did say, you know, if you go out, like you said, it's intentionally you borrow money not to pay. That is terrible. That mustn't happen.
But will the lender let you get away with it?
He mustn't. I mean, if you come to think of it, the money that has been is been lent to you, money, it belongs to some people.
Yeah.
There are interests behind this money. If you go to a bank and you want to borrow money from your bank, the bank doesn't print money. So the money that the bank is going to give to you is the money they've collected from depositors.
And that brings me to the question of the other time, you know, former President Obasanjo went around, you know, seeking for debt forgiveness, which we got. Is that forgiveness or cancellation really, you know, what it is? Cancellation without strings attached?
Yes, essentially. I know where you're coming from. You're looking at, you see the desktop. What is happening is that when you have issues and you're not servicing your debt the way you service it, and so the things you don't pay, they're capitalized. And so most of these things are arrears, penalties, and so on and so forth. So invariably, before we even get to the stage where you start having some crisis, the capital expenditure, the money that was lent to you, must have been collected. So the thing about debt is that you're supposed to pay 10 naira today, you don't pay it, we'll add it to what is there. And we'll now, that's punitive. Rate of interest that it's imposed on this is punitive.
Mm.
And so it accumulates. So when you find the thing that is, you see it,
so
on the books.
You have finished paying the major sum.
Yes. And so then what you are, what is happening now is that you've not kept to, you know, the terms, you know, of agreement we had when I lent you this money.
Mm-hmm.
And so that being the case, there are penalties that attach. There are legitimate penalties. So that's why Okonjo-Iweala came and she was able to write off for us almost $18 billion. That's what she did. And we paid some money, you know, and there was an outcry. Yes.
Now, doctor.
Mm. No, but I was going to talk about this, the plan to pay back.
Okay.
Also, I think that we should also address this. We do budget every year. And when we do our budget, there's an allocation for debt servicing. It's there. Well, unfortunately, you know, in the past, we used to have a budget and they gather us together, and then half yearly we'll have presentations on what has happened to the budget that we've articulated over the period. It's not mean we've not been doing it. That is now without practice. So even if they're paying this amount of money, and the actual implementation of the budget itself is not transparent to we, the commentators, people out there. But every budget exercise, there's an allocation that is put reserved, you know, for debt servicing. And I would expect that for them to do that, and this is, they'll have to work with debt management office, you know, to say what would carry us over the fiscal year to be in tune with the requirement for our servicing our debts.
Hmm.
I thought I should address this so that...
Okay. Now, this is very pertinent as far as I'm concerned. Festus says, my confusion is why we have to borrow all the time when we have over 47 billion in reserve.
But
why do you have all that money put away and you're still borrowing?
Well, you see, the money in reserve, you know, it's not, you don't use it to, it has such some purpose. It has some purpose. It has a different purpose.
What is the purpose?
Now, essentially, the purpose is that, you know, if you can't do external trade, if you don't have money in reserves.
Okay.
Okay, so, you know, if we do trade, we just did a currency swap with People's Republic of China. Okay, you can go down that road whereby you can buy things from China and we just pay Naira. But if people are going to trade with you, they're looking at your reserves. And if, you know, looking at the risk factor, and this is why we say, for instance, you know, your reserves must be able to, for instance, accommodate at least 3 months of your imports.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's not just money sitting there. And there are some issues about this money in the reserves. Because the money in the reserves, you know, what's happening is that this money accrues and it's monetized. You know, so there are issues, you know, we're going to the papers okay. and the arguments, you know. So it's sent to Naira. And that money belongs to the central bank. Okay.
Let me go to Mr. Fashua. Professor Aboki Eze, that's an interesting name, on Twitter is asking a question, and maybe you will have an answer. He says, why will Nigerian government borrow? The recovered looted funds were supposed to be used to service the debt. What do you think about that?
Oh, well, that goes back to the question of accountability on the part of the current government. You know, I mean, there's total opacity regarding how much has been collected back from all of these looters and where the money is. I was listening to something during the week where someone said the presidential special assistant, I think Mrs. Ibekaku, who's in charge of that very transaction, says that a lot of the assets are actually devaluing and they're dissipating in value. And that is difficult to track the value at each point in time. And that's the reason why they are not telling the public anything at all. At least you should tell the people some things. So you should tell, look, when we say that a government should be transparent, it is for the purpose of that government. It is for their own good. The moment you don't start out being transparent, you are never going to be able to get back to that level of transparency. And people will say all sorts of things and you'll be there fighting fires. All right, but let me say something historically regarding our debts in the past. And there's this thing about debt also being an instrument of capture. Pre-2006, we had debts with the so-called Paris and the London Club. The London Club is where you have variable rates, meaning that, you know, the borrowings we took from the London Club was tied to the LIBOR, the London Interbank Offering Offer Rate, LIBOR, which is a variable rate. And that means that if the rate goes up, the rate that we're paying back also goes up. The Paris Club is the more stable one where we had fixed rate borrowing. However, Obasanjo will say around 2004-05 that Nigeria borrowed 12 billion. Nigeria paid back 35 billion, or rather, we paid back 38 billion in cash flow, but we were still owing 35 billion. And so we were given, out of 35 billion, the 30 billion was the London Club aspect there. So what they gave us was that to say, okay, pay 18 billion, pay $12 billion and we'll give you 18 billion off. And therefore they wrote off 30 billion from our loan, but we paid 12 billion in that regard. As at that time, the rate of, you know, exchange rate was 120. So precisely that was about 1.4 trillion naira that we repaid back. Nigeria was the only country in sub-Saharan Africa that was made to pay back any amount of money because the debt cancellation at that point in time was a general debt cancellation for all low-income countries in the world. And at that time, I think the guys who were holding this debt, the owners of the debt, you know, probably felt a bit contrite that they had sucked the life out of all of these economies. Unfortunately for us, this is the year 2018, and we're getting less transparency in terms of our debt. We're getting less transparency and less accountability from our government. We should by now be getting a blow-by-blow account of where this is, how much have we recovered, how do we intend to pay, what are we borrowing for, and I insist that we should be borrowing for things that have some kind of fungibility, some kind of cash flow attached to them. But now we're borrowing everywhere, and as Dr. Boniface has said, you know, some of these things are a bit spurious, you know. But when we're borrowing, we present a very good face. It looks like everything is okay. But wait until the time the owner of the debt show up. I don't know how we're going to get out of this one that we're in now because it's massive. Now, the debt profile has increased from 9 trillion in the Jonathan days when he left to 22 trillion today, which is something else. But let me also quickly say that part of the reason why you had that phenomenal increase, which is over 100% increase in our debt profile between then and now, is because we also devalued our currency. When if Nigeria would devalue its currency today by, let's say, 50%, in which case, if Naira became 600 today, you know, and most of that debt will also double, all right, because the debts are domiciled in foreign currency. And of course, there's a strategy by government, deliberate strategy, to move away from local debt, which is domestic debt, into foreign debt, which they are getting at a cheaper interest rate. However, the corollary or the danger or the risk factor there is that if you devalue again, your debt goes maybe sometimes double. Of course, we know that Jonathan left the Naira at around 176 or thereabout. Today is 305 officially, and that affects the debt profile. So any which way you slice it or dice it, the Nigerian government must be extremely careful, because I'm not sure that the world will be generous again to sit down and say, okay, we want to cancel them. Apart from that, many of the African countries or the sub-Saharan African countries, and even many of these countries in South America, in Asia, everybody is sitting up now. And I would also repeat this, everybody is sitting up now. Look, the budget for Bangladesh this year, which is, they are almost the same population as Nigeria. Bangladesh is budgeting $50 billion this year. Anybody can actually go and check that on the internet. $50 billion is, and our budget is $25 billion. So look, not only are we having a problem with corruption, we're also very under-imaginative. We're not imagining enough. We have now fallen into some level of mediocrity that we're not thinking big enough. And of course, the quick escape is, let's go and borrow some money. Look, we can get a lot more money from looking at our petroleum industry bill, from going to look for it wherever it is. It seems to be lost now. The reason why Angola is budgeting $47 to $56 billion this year, as against Nigeria's $25 billion, is because they got their petroleum bill right for some reason. I don't know what happened. You know, places like Algeria are budgeting $68 billion this year. So we can do that. We can get money from petroleum industry. We can get a lot more money from capital gains taxes, from properties that are sold all over this country. We can get money from there. We can get even more money, of course, from compliance on VAT and company income tax. We can even reduce company income tax marginally in order to encourage people to we can get money from inheritance taxes, which we have in our laws but are not being used. Because okay. The big guys, the elites, have not quite reached the consensus that this country should grow. And again, okay. What I always tell them is that the elite and the rich people can make more money in this country.
Okay.
If only they will understand
that
it doesn't work for them to just keep so many people poor.